Okay, so good morning. I think we can start. Okay, so the plan of my lectures is to introduce the content of a series of papers I wrote with Nicola Gigli and Giuseppe Savarè. Well, we wrote this paper roughly between 2010 and 2012. There are three long papers. One is about calculus. This paper is basically about a new point of view on calculus in metric measure spaces and also on the theory of heat flow. The second paper is about metric measure spaces. With Riemannian. Ricci lower bounds. And the most recent one, which appeared last year, is about the connection between these points of view and the Bakri-Emery theory. So the title is roughly Riemannian, Ricci lower bounds, and the Bakri-Emery. Theory. Okay, so I think I will spend just the first hour with a kind of overview and some motivations, and then I will try to be a bit detailed about the first part. I will really try to enter into some details of the proofs and so on. And I think I will use my last hour just to say something about part two and part three. Okay, so the questions that we try to answer is there a good theory of Riemannian, as the title of the second paper says, a good theory of Riemannian Ricci lower bounds for metric measure spaces? So we add to the metric structure the measure structure, and I will always use this notation, XDM, M for the reference measure. Okay, to start, maybe I will start with an important analogy, which is the theory. So let's say, let us forget for a moment about the measure, and let us speak only about metric spaces. And here there is an important analogy, and also a very successful theory, which is the so-called Alexandrov theory. Which does not work for Ricci, but it works for sectional curvature. Let's say upper, lower bounds for sectional curvature. This was a theory initiated by Alexandrov and very well developed by the Russian school. The main names are maybe Burago, Ivanov, Petrunin, Perelman. And it is based on a geodesic triangle comparison. So to make it as simple as possible, let me say just the case of curvature non-positive, non-negative. So we say that, for instance, XD is a space with NPC, which means a sectional curvature non-negative, if you have a convexity inequality satisfied by the squared Wasserstein distance. So if you fix two points, Z0 and Z1, and any other point x, you look at the behavior of the square distance from x along a geodesic joining z0 to z1. So this will be a geodesic ZT joining z0 to z1. And you require for non-negative curvature, sorry, non-positive here. So this will be, this will be the case of, actually, this will be the case of positive curvature, while this will be the case of negative curvature. Right? In this case, you are in the case of negative curvature. In this case, you are in the case of positive curvature. And of course, this corresponds to the case of zero curvature. So let's say for the case of negative curvature, this is. Square of z0 x plus t over 2 d square of z1 x, and here there is a constant t1 minus t over 2, if I remember well. D square z0 z1. Okay, so you're just asking for a convexity property. Kind of modified convexity property, you know, with this modulus of continuity for the square of the distance from any point. Okay, and what are the merits of this theory? The main points are that it is strongly consistent. So what I mean by this, that if you look for this, of course, this theory does not involve any curvature and any derivative of the metric tensor. So let's say that you are in a Riemannian manifold where, however, you can compute the sectional curvature in the classical way. Then on a Riemannian manifold, this property is satisfied if and only if classically it is satisfied. So by strongly consistent, I mean this property. And one of the merits is also that it is stable under Gromov-Hausdorff limits. So you might start from classical spaces. Smooth Riemannian manifold, so you may take a limit in the sense of Gromov-Hausdorff, right? Which is the natural notion of convergence for metric spaces. And then the limit object will be only in general a metric space. But you can still make a sense of this condition in your limit space, and I think it is pretty clear because this is a pointwise inequality that this condition is stable. Under Gromov-Hausdorff convergence. Okay, so this is ex an extremely successful theory, which can be used as a guideline for the Ricci theory, which, as we will see in a moment, also the Ricci theory is based on suitable convexity property. So now what happens? If we add the measure into the picture, well, this ingredient is important for many applications because, for instance, in many cases you can describe in limiting procedures some concentration effects of volume, right? So in the limit you have not only a distance but you have a limit volume measure. Of course, you might think that in classical situation the measure is generated out of the distance, right? For instance, on a Riemannian manifold, you will take as M simply the volume measure of the manifold. Or maybe in some other spaces you might take as M a suitable Hausdorff measure the Hausdorff measure, the k-dimensional Hausdorff measure associated to the metric space. But maybe in some cases you don't have a natural dimension. So your non-natural way to associate to the distance the measure. And so we will see that it is much, much nicer and much more natural also from the point of view of differentiable calculus to consider them as decoupled, even if in some situation they are coupled. Okay, so here there are basically two theories, the Bakri-Emery theory, which uses actually very little the distance, as we will see in a moment, but more the measure, and the theory of Lott, Sturm, and Villani, which uses actually both. Distance and measure are heavily used in this point of view. And okay, just also to start to use also the same terminology of Guido yesterday, we could say that this is an Eulerian theory. And this is a kind of Lagrangian theory. And so in order to connect the two theories, of course, where you are in an osmooth world, you have to develop new tools connecting the Eulerian and the Lagrangian viewpoint. And this is precisely, the connection is done precisely by the optimal transportation. Okay, so now in this overview, I just say quickly what is the, let me start from the Bakri-Emery theory, which is, I think, much more intuitive than the Lott Sturm-Villani theory. Well, the Bakri-Emery theory is based on a classical equality, which is called Bochner identity. And it says that the Laplacian, if you are, let's say, on a Riemannian manifold, well, all these objects make sense. This is equal to the scalar product. Of course, here we should use the metric to compute the scalar product between gradients. Plus the norm of the Hessian square plus the Ricci tensor applied to the gradient. Okay, so it's a quadratic function in F, which you can write in this way. Okay, now what happens? It happens that you can easily turn this identity into an inequality. By saying that, I mean, if your manifold is n-dimensional, you can use the Schwarz inequality to bound this from below with the trace of this matrix, which is again the Laplacian. So, and here you will get the Laplacian of F squared over n. And if you know that the Ricci curvature is greater than k, I mean in the sense of tensors, right? Greater than k times the identity, here you get. And so in this way, in some sense, you get rid of the two dangerous terms which you can't define, at least you can't define easily in an osmooth world, okay? While, on the other hand, we will see in a moment that in an osmooth world, all these objects, gradient of F, Laplacian of F, can be defined. So how are these objects defined in the Bakri-Emery theory? Okay, anyhow, let me summarize now the Bakri-Emery, the so-called Bakri-Emery KN condition. It's really amounts to write maybe in an integral form, in a distributional form, the inequality that the Laplacian minus this is the Bakri-Emery condition. Well, so very briefly, how I will not spend so much time on the Bakri-Emery theory, but I want just to convey the essential ideas. In the Bakri-Emery theory, the starting point is usually a semi-group, the heat flow, which is called the heat flow. So you start from a linear self-adjoint order-preserving semigroup. And so you see to define the semigroup, you typically need only these two ingredients. A priori, you don't have any distance to start with. And then out of this, you have the Laplacian, which is the infinitesimal generator. So it's a totally functional analytic approach. Of PT, and then you have the Laplacian, and out of the Laplacian, basically with an integration by parts, let me say formally, but this can be made rigorous, how can you define the gradient square? Just to integrate, and this construction can be localized. So you see that even without having a distance a priori, you are able to define something which plays the role of the gradient. And then you see, you have all the ingredients to state this condition. Well, this theory has many merits, and in particular, let's say, among the strong merits of this theory are the derivation in sharp form, I mean with the sharp constants of many functional or many, let's say, geometric and functional inequalities. So this is a very powerful theory from this point of view. And for instance, we could mention the isoperimetric, the Poincaré inequality, the so-called Liao parabolic inequality, and many others. I mean, all these inequalities can be totally derived using this calculus based on this weak Bochner inequality. So this is an extremely powerful theory, and it's also very intuitive because it uses a formalism which is very close to the classical formalism you would use on a Riemannian manifolds. Maybe what are the limitations? Limitations are in some sense that some aspects like localization globalization and also some issues related to stability of this theory. For instance, what happens if you take a limits of spaces, a limits of semigroups? Is it true that the limit semigroup satisfies the same condition? What is the limit semigroup? So many issues related to this localization, stabilization are not so clear. And maybe one of the reasons is that the role of the distance is in somehow hidden. So you don't see really the distance in this point of view. Although eventually you can recover a distance, but I will not say how. Okay, now let me go instead to the Locke-Sturm-Villani side. Which is more recent. So this theory started in the 80s, while the Locke-Sturm-Villani theory goes back to the last 10 years. And okay, let me start again from a smooth picture. So let's say we are on a Riemannian manifold, and d, of course, is the induced Riemannian distance. And we consider this family of transform maps. Okay, you see, this is the family of transform maps which basically appear also in the Brenier theorem about the existence of optimal maps. For instance, in R n, this will be simply mean. Where phi is a C concave map and so on. So here is the connection with the optimal transport. In general, if you want to describe optimal maps in Riemannian manifolds, you should use the exponential map. Okay, and now the question is that Ricci curvature appears not only in the Bochner identity, but appears also when you try to compute the evolution So you see this as a family of maps from M to M indexed by T, and then you can look for the evolution of the gradients. This is a Riccati equation that I will not write. What is more important for us is the evolution of this scalar equation. Which I will call JT of X. So the Jacobian of this of the determinants, the Jacobian determinants of these maps. And then it turns out that this satisfies a differential inequality. T equals 0. This is greater than the Laplacian, and here you really see some kind of analogy with the Bakri-Emery condition. Again, you see the Laplacian divided by the dimension plus Ricci curvature. And again, you see you can say that Ricci is greater than a constant. Say okay, so now the question is, can we give a meaning to this differential inequality also on a metric measure space? Right? So the main difference you see is that we are not using the heat flow, but we are using this kind of Jacobians. Well, the answer is yes. And we can use the convexity properties of the entropy. So let me introduce now the entropy. So as I said, we look for an integral form of this inequality. Yeah. There is a T, right, sorry. I simply forgot to write it.
Oh,
Sorry, yeah, it is a family of maps which at time zero should give you the identity. Okay, thank you. And very well. So let me introduce now the entropy. So the entropy functional, actually for later uses, more convenient to view this as a functional of measures. So we put this functional equal to plus infinity if mu is not absolutely continuous with respect to m. So mu will be a probability measure in my space. I will use p for the space of probability measures, as also Guido was doing. And then in the case where mu has a density, is the standard. Okay, this is also a good point to make a few standing assumptions that I will always do in my lectures. So that, I mean, with these standing assumptions, all the objects that I'm going to use are well defined. Well, first of all, I will assume for simplicity that this is compact. And that m will be finite, let's say even a probability measure, finite, and so I will normalize it to be a probability measure. And maybe I will always assume to simplify that the support of m is equal to x. Okay? So under this assumption, we know that the entropy is non-negative, is a non-negative functional. Okay, so of course, all the things that I'm going to illustrate can be extended because it's important to include in the theory, for instance, the Euclidean space, which is not compact, or measures which are only finite on bounded set. But this creates a lot of technical complications. And so in my lecture, I will always stick to this situation. But none of them is essential. Right. And so let's say that we want to compute the density. So let us go back to a Riemannian classical framework. And we want, I want to, I, com I define now mu t equal to tt sharp of mu 0. Okay. For t sufficiently small, this is a geodesic. And let us compute the value of the entropy along this geodesic. Okay, so first of all, there is the area formula. By the change of variables formula, you can check that mu t has still a density. Mu t has still a density with respect to m, but what is more important is that since we are in a smooth situation, we can compute explicitly the density using the area formula. And that the density is precisely rho 0 over the Jacobian over Gt with the map I call the Gt composition with the Tt to the minus 1. Okay? So this is just change of variables formula. Actually, you see, one of the main problems when you do this in a metric space is that you don't have the change of variables formula. So you have to bypass somehow this computation. But here we can really do an explicit computation. And then we compute the entropy. So the entropy will be equal by, will be equal to, again, rho 0 over jt, composition tt to the minus 1, log rho 0 over jt, composition with tt to the minus 1, dm. Okay, and now we should change variables. When we change variables, you see this factor jt disappears, and we get that this is the integral of rho 0 log of rho 0 over jt dx. Let's say, to emphasize that here I'm changing variables, let me call x the variable here and y the variable here. Okay? So here I made the change of variables y equal to tt of x. And then you see we get that this is equal to the initial entropy minus rho 0 log of jt. And remember that log of, minus log of jt was precisely the quantity which had this convexity property. Point, the one which had this pointwise convexity property I wrote before. And so this leads to the so-called CD0 infinity condition. For the moment, I just stated that with k equals 0. So for the moment, infinity means that I'm not putting any upper bound on the dimension. I'm completely neglecting the Laplacian term. And let's also, to simplify even more, because now I'm just making a survey, just let me put k equals 0. So I'm just saying that Ricci is non-negative. And then this means that I only use the information that this quantity is convex. And so the CDK infinity condition is that the entropy is convex along, let's say, Wasserstein geodesics. I mean the geodesics given by the optimal transportation distance, right? The optimal transportation distance for me will always be the one with the quadratic cost. So for me the cost in the general overview that Guido is doing, we have to choose as a cost function simply the square of the distance. Okay, and this is basically the Lot-Villani, so part of the Lot-Villani Stone, because then we had to add the dependence on K, the dependence of N, but we will see this later on, how we can add also all these parameters. Here I just want to emphasize that, again, this is based on a suitable convexity property.
Very well. Okay, so what are now
the limits, again, the merits and the limitations of this theory? Again, the big merit is a strong consistency. Actually, for any values of the parameters, if you look to, for the appropriate condition on a Riemannian manifold, it is satisfied if and only if it is satisfied in a classical sense. We have stability under measured Gromov-Hausdorff of limits. So here we have to add the measured because we are dealing with metric measure spaces. So there is a variant of the Gromov-Hausdorff theory which allows to deal also with limits of metric measure spaces. Okay? But I will never have time to illustrate this. I just mention it. Okay, now let me go instead to the limitations. What are the limitations of this theory? Well, a technical limitation is that everything here is based on optimal transportation, we will see on geodesics and so on. And it turns out that many results depend on the so-called non-branching assumption. So non-branching means that your metric space should have this property, that it is impossible for a geodesic to split, for a minimizing geodesic, of course. So you should, many results, for instance, the derivation of, the initial derivation of Poincaré inequality in this theory was based on this assumption. This is a big limitation because this condition by itself is not stable. So we are putting again into play an unstable condition. For instance, L infinity, which is the typical example of a branching space, L infinity in R2, is the limit in any reasonable sense of LP. So all these spaces are strongly uniformly convex, so they are non-branching, the limit is branching, so you see. And again, L infinity comes into play in describing another limitation of this theory. Well, this is maybe a bit controversial whether this is a limitation or not. Let me first state the result and then I will explain. So let's say Rn endowed with any norm. So choose any norm in Rn and use this norm to generate the distance. And we take as measure always the Lebesgue measure. Satisfies CD0 infinity. And actually even the dimensional one, but that we will see maybe later on. This is some sense, so in some sense, this axiomatization is not sufficiently strong to distinguish between different norms. So on one end, one might see, well, okay, it's a good point because in this theory we have many examples. So from this point of view, it's not a limitation. On the other hand, it is a limitation from if you see it from the point of view of the what we might call the Cheeger Colding program. So what is the Cheeger Colding program? The program of Cheeger Colding was to describe limits, I mean, Gromov-Hausdorff or measure Gromov-Hausdorff limits or Riemann or classical objects of Riemannian manifolds under, let's say, Ricci plus volume or diameter bounds, under Ricci lower bounds plus volume. other. Because, of course, we can use the fact that this theory is strongly is consistent and stable to say that any limit in this program, or trying to describe the closure of Riemannian manifolds, any limit object satisfies the CD zero infinity condition, right? On the other hand, if you look only to the CD zero infinity condition, in principle, for instance, L infinity might appear as limits of these manifolds. Right. Well, on the other hand, using the so-called splitting theorem, and I think Nicola in the last week will speak about this result, the approximate splitting theorem. Implies that, for instance, L infinity is not in the closure. So it was already known that it is impossible to reach spaces like L infinity by closing Riemannian manifolds. But you don't see this phenomenon using only the CD KM theory. And so, in fact, this was our starting point. Our starting point was precisely to try to whether to find a stronger axiomatization. So the question that we answer is there a Riemannian CDKN theory which can we use to rule out L infinity and other examples? And since I says to get a better description of the closure of Riemannian manifolds, and how does it relate to the other theory, to the Bakri-Emery? Now, the answer to these two questions basically depends on a deeper understanding of calculus, of the heat flow in metric measure spaces. So in a sense, the technical part of my lectures where I'm really going to give precise statements and some proofs will be dealing with this part. And maybe only in the last hour I will state the answers, but unavoidably without proofs to these two questions. Okay? So this is my plan.
Very well. Okay, so maybe I use now the 15 minutes before the break to introduce a little bit of terminology and basic tools. So I already wrote my standing assumptions, some basic tools.
Well, the first one is the notion of absolutely continuous map and metric derivative. OK. Okay, so let's say if I take an interval I into R, and if I take a gamma from I into R, I say that gamma is absolutely continuous. If for some there exists some g in L1, I, non-negative of course, for which you have this inequality. So you see, in this way, absolutely continuity is just a purely metric concept. And then you may wonder, what is the smallest function g that you can put in this inequality?
Sorry, yeah? The image of gamma should be x.
Ah, sorry, right, sorry. X, right, thank you. Pardon? Ah, right. Sorry. Yeah. Okay. And then you may wonder, okay, if you have some G, so absolute continuity is defined by the existence of this function G, you may wonder what is the minimal function G. The minimal function G exists up to negligible set, and it is the, what we call the metric derivative. So this is a notation, right? Is reminiscent of the fact that in a classical context you will take the gamma prime, which is a vector, and the modulus of gamma prime. Here we are in a metric context, so you should take this just as a notation. And this is the limit as h goes to 0. Okay, and the part of the statement is the existence of this limit almost everywhere. So this limit exists almost everywhere in I, and provides you precisely the smallest function for which you have this inequality. Okay, and analogously you can define ACP for P. Okay, ACP is simply defined with requiring G to be in LP. So that, for instance, AC infinity corresponds to Lipschitz functions. Okay, so this is, in a sense, the basic Lagrangian definition. And the basic Eulerian definition is the notion of slope. So we want to define basically the modulus of a grade, let's say modulus, well, you have to be careful and distinguish even formally between gradients and differentials. So we'll use D just to remember that we have in mind the differentials and not gradients. So let's say for a Lipschitz function, this is the so-called slope, or also called in the literature pointwise Lipschitz constant. It's simply the Linsup as y goes to x of the f of y minus f of x dy x. Okay. Okay, this I don't need for a moment. And when we will be speaking about the CDKN theory, it will be convenient to use another formulation. Okay, let's say this is 2. Another formulation of the optimal transport problem that I will not, I think Guido will not speak about this, so I should introduce it briefly. And then we can make a break. So the so-called time-dependent or dynamic formulation of the optimal transport problem. Okay, in the classical presentation of the optimal transport problem, you only care, you know, about the initial and final position, which you can imagine that they are glued by a map or by a plan, as Guido was illustrating before, yesterday. But what happens in this geometric context, it starts to be important also to know, in some sense, dynamically what happens in between, so the path that you follow in going from x to y. Okay? So how can we do this? So let's say that mu and nu are probability measures in x. So these are the typical data of the optimal transport problem. The cost is 1/2 d squared. And let me introduce the so-called action of gamma. The action of gamma, oh, no, before maybe I should introduce my space. I will introduce the space of absolutely continuous maps. AC2. And I view this as a subspace of this space. So this is a Polish space. This is complete and separable, and this is a sigma closed subset of this space. And so I have no problem in considering probability measures inside this space. Okay? So, strictly speaking, these are probability measures in this space which are concentrated on this Borel subset. And I will call this dynamic transference plan or dynamic plan. And you see, by this probability measure, I encode really the information also of the path that I'm going to follow to go from x to y. Okay, another notation that I will use is the evaluation map . So this will be the evaluation at time t. Et of gamma will be simply gamma at time t. Sometimes I will also use this notation. And then I will introduce the action. Very much like in Riemannian geometry, the action of a curve in AC2 is simply the integral between, maybe I will put 1/2 here. Oh no, maybe not. T. And notice that exactly like in the classical case, one can show that this is always greater than the length of gamma squared. The proofs are exactly the same using the definitions I already gave of metric derivative and absolute continuity, with the quality if and only if gamma is a length minimizing curve with constant speed. And this is also greater, of course, than gamma of 1, than the distance square between gamma 1 and gamma 0. Okay? And now the idea is that in order to formulate the optimal transport problem in a dynamical way, instead of minimizing this, I minimize this. So the dynamic optimal transport problem is you minimize gamma, and now eta will be a probability measure in AC2. Now, how can I specify the initial and final constraint? I will use just the evaluation maps. So E0 sharp of eta should be equal to mu, and D1 sharp of eta should be equal to nu. And this is actually this is exactly the problem So there is this theorem which tells us that this is just a reformulation of the usual problem illustrated by Guido. So theorem, if XD is a geodesic space, let's say it's a length space, so this means that any given any two points, there is a length minimizing curve between the two points with length equal to the distance, then the minimum in the dynamica optimal transport problem, again, is equal to the minimum in the Kantorovich problem. So it's the same problem. It's only that it is more descriptive, because now we can really say that eta is concentrated on geodesics with constant speed you see because of this inequality in the case of equality you get that eta is concentrated on geodesics with constant speed. And if you want to make also the connection between minimizers, you will find that E0, E1 sharp of eta, you see this is a probability measure in X cross X, is a minimizer. In the Kantorovich problem. And actually this is a complete description. Right. So given a minimizer in the Kantorovich problem, if you connect any two points by constant speed geodesic, you build an eta. Right. But it will be convenient to view, we will see immediately, maybe even today, that it will be convenient to use this language of probability measures in the space of curves to develop a calculus. And so, okay, so I think I can stop here for 10 or 15 minutes. Okay, so I think that today I will only speak about the problem of Sobolev spaces on metric measure spaces. So in some sense, to develop some calculus, it seems natural to develop a kind of a theory of weakly differentiable functions. Okay, so let me remind you also to make a kind of analogy, classical analogy, that in the already in the classical theory of Sobolev spaces, which was developed in the 50s, there were two competing definitions: the H definition, which is obtained by approximation, with smooth functions, I mean here I'm speaking of course in Rn, and then there is the so-called WAP in space, which is based by integration by parts. And then there is a famous paper by Meyer-Serrin, whose title is precisely H equal W. So they proved in quite general domains using convolutions, partitions of unity, that the two spaces coincide. So what we are going to do basically today and also part of tomorrow is to revisit all these things in a metric measure space. Okay, let me start from the H definition. The H definition was revisited by Cheeger. So this is the theory of relaxed gradients. And these were revisited by, introduced by Cheeger in his famous paper on geometric and functional analysis his motivation was to develop a kind of Rademacher theorem in metric measure spaces. He had slightly different motivations, but he proposed this definition. Propose this definition of Sobolev space. So we say that F belongs to the space H1P XM XDM. And now the roles of the distance and of the measure will be very clear in this definition, how they interact. If you can find there exists Fn, which are Lipschitz, which converge to F in LP. Okay, let me say that here for me, P will be always between, okay, maybe I will stick to the case P equal 2 for simplicity, because it's the only one relevant for my lectures. Fn converge to F in L2. And so the role of smooth functions is played here by Lipschitz functions, and the gradients, the role of the gradient is played by the local Lipschitz constant. Okay. And so you see here the interaction of distance and measure, because to define the local Lipschitz constant, you need a distance, and then you have to weight this quantity using your measure. And then associated to this definition, we can call a relaxed slope, which is a non-empty subset of L2 for any function in H1, 2. All weak L2 limits. Yeah. So associated to any family FN, you have many, a priori, many weak limits of these quantities because this is a family bounded in L2. You take all weak limits, you take all functions which are greater than a weak limit. So here, of course, I mean a subsequence. And for all possible approximations, right? Actually, it's technically convenient. I will not explain this. This is based on the so-called Mazur lemma on a convexification argument to show that this is equivalent also to this definition. Is equivalent to G is greater than a strong L2 limit of GN greater than DFN. Well, the passage from weak to strong convergence is due to a convexification argument. You know that you can turn by convexification weakly convergent sequence into strongly convergent. Okay, and this is also a useful characterization of the relaxed slopes. Okay, and then again we want to identify a minimal object. And here it comes into play the second characterization. So first of all, for instance, you can use even the first one to show that this set is convex. It's a convex subset of L2. But, I mean, it's difficult using this characterization to show the closure because you can't make diagonal arguments using the weak topology, while you can do them using this characterization. And so it turns out that RS of F is a closed and convex in L2. And so we can single out in this class an element with minimal norm, which I will denote by DF star, which is the minimal relaxed gradient. Okay, is the unique element with minimal L2 norm among all relaxed gradients. And then I will call Cheeger energy simply the integral of the minimal relaxed gradient. And so this object plays in the theory the role of the Dirichlet energy in the more classical theories. In fact, one can show, basically using, again, this kind of characterization, that this is a convex and lower semi-continuous. Energy. By convention, you can put it to plus infinity, as in the classical theory of minimization of the Dirichlet energy on L2 minus H12. Okay, so when I mean lower semi-continuous, I mean L2 lower semi-continuous. So I view this as a functional in L2. And I set it to plus infinity on L2 minus H12. Okay, and then let's see what we can do with this. Well, there are now some elementary calculus rules which already show that some classical properties are retained in this setting. So the basic facts are first of all, the chain rule. So we have the standard chain rule. So here there is an inequality. Of course, this object is defined up to negligible set because it's a function in L2. And with equality, if phi prime is non-negative, and another useful factor that we will see in a moment is the so-called decomposability. Of the class of relaxed slopes. Decomposability means that if I have any two relaxed slopes, and if I take any Borel set in X, I can combine the two. So the function which will be equal to the characteristic function of B times G1 plus the characteristic function of the complement of B times G2 is a relaxed slope. And for instance, now using precisely the decomposability, one can show a pointwise minimality property. Pointwise minimality property, which says that for any G which is in a relaxed slope. So remember that we defined the minimal relaxed slope by minimizing an integral quantity, the L2 norm. But a posteriori we can say that this quantity is minimal in the almost everywhere sense. So for any relaxed slope, we have this inequality. Why? And the proof is simple. Let's say if this set has positive measure, if this set has positive measure, and call this set equal to B, then G tilde, which is equal to G times the characteristic of B plus DF star, the characteristic of X minus B, is a relaxed slope which is strictly with a strictly smaller norm. So first of all, it is a relaxed slope by the decomposability property, and the norm of G tilde is strictly less than the norm which contradicts the minimality. And so because of the minimality property, you get also the pointwise minimality property. Okay, these are good news, but now let me say some kind of bad news or say some warnings. Well, Well, the first one, which you actually will be very important for our axiomatization of the Riemannian theory, is that in general, the Cheeger energy is not quadratic. So you are integrating the square of something, but this object is not quadratic. And in particular, I didn't say that, of course, in H12 you can put the norm. Is not Hilbert. So this is not an Hilbertian norm. And actually, one of the main goals of Cheeger's paper is also to prove that even if this is not an Hilbert norm, in some situations one can build an equivalent Hilbert norm. But in some sense, the natural norm in this space is not an Hilbert norm. And so let me give you an example why this happens. Okay, let me say that this is equivalent to the best result is a result I got last year with Di Marino and Savarin. Di Marino and Colombo. So which improves a little Cheeger's paper. So under some assumption one can find an equivalent Hilbert norm, but not in general. So let me give you an example of this phenomenon. Very simple. Again, we go back to L-infinity. Yeah, maybe my notation of L-infinity might have created some confusion. I meant by L-infinity, I didn't mean the space of sequences. I just meant Rn with the sub-norm, okay? Just a finite dimensional space. Okay, let's say even n equal 2. And you see, so in this case, in some sense, and here you see also the dual nature of df, because the distance is the L-infinity norm. So since this is a norm on differentials, should be dual, and so you can easily compute that the slope or the minimal relaxed slope is the L1 norm. And so this means that square. And so this is not a quadratic form. If you integrate this, you are not getting a quadratic form. Okay? It's too homogeneous, but not a quadratic form. So the notation can be a little misleading, but keep in mind that in general, we are not dealing with a quadratic form. The second important warning . So we are going to see very general result, which basically identify again H equal to W and also many other results which almost require no assumption on the metric measure structure. But the warning that in some cases all objects can be trivial. So maybe they are identified, but they are simply trivial. And so let me make a simple example. Take as your space 0, 1. As M, you take Lebesgue measure. I'm sorry, as distance, you take the Euclidean distance. Instead of taking the Lebesgue measure, you take a very concentrated measure, which is where this is the standard any enumeration of the rational numbers of 0, 1. Then in this case, one can show that the Cheeger energy is identically zero. So in this case, H12 actually coincides with L2, and the Cheeger energy is identically zero. So this means that, at some stage, some additional assumption on the metric mesh structure should come into play to say that these objects are not trivial. So how we can prove this? Well, the idea is that, maybe I give you just a very quick sketch of the construction. So let's take any Lipschitz function, or C1 if you like. And define Fn as the integral Fn of t as f of 0 plus the integral between 0 and t of f prime kn ds, where kn is the characteristic function of an open set An. And these open sets contain the rational numbers. And the Lebesgue measure of An goes to 0. Is the 1 minus Kn. So since you know Kn converge to 0 in L1 or 0,1, clearly Fn converge to F uniformly. But Fn prime is equal, the slope of Fn or the derivative of Fn is equal to 0 on An. And so it is 0 almost everywhere. And so this means that I have found an approximating sequence on which the energy is identically zero. And so my Cheeger energy is identically zero. Okay. And so you may wonder when these objects are non-trivial, for instance, a positive result. So I already said that the space has an equivalent norm if you have this doubling condition. And one also, the main results of this paper by Cheeger is that the doubling condition for the measure plus the Poincaré inequality and maybe I write now on this board the Poincaré inequality, the local Poincaré inequality. The local Poincaré inequality says that there are many equivalent formulations, but that you can control the deviation of f from its mean by a constant, maybe in a slightly larger ball. lambda greater than 1 and c greater than 0, which of course should be independent of r, times the local Lipschitz constant. So it's a kind of structural assumption on the metric measure structure, which is satisfied in many important cases. So under the Poincaré inequality condition plus the doubling property for the measure, one obtains that, for instance, and this should be taught really as a kind of Rademacher theorem, these objects are non-trivial. For instance, on Lipschitz functions, they coincide with the local Lipschitz constant. And it is clear that the local Lipschitz constant is not trivial, right? In many spaces, this is not a trivial object, and so also this is not trivial. This is a very deep result. I mean, I just mentioned this for completeness. Okay. Okay, now let us start to look to the Laplacian, still in this framework, in the framework of the relaxed gradient of the H Sobolev spaces. Let us look to the Laplacian and heat flow. Okay, in order to define both the Laplacian and the heat flow, we have a very established theory, which is the theory of maximal monotone operators. Which was developed by Komura, Brezis, and many others in the 70s. So let me remind you the basic facts. I mean, the basic facts are that you have an Hilbert space, which in our case will be L2. You have an energy functional phi from H into R union plus infinity, convex and lower semi-continuous. And in our case, the energy functional is the Cheeger energy with the 1/2. And given these ingredients, first of all, you can define the so-called sub-differential. So I will denote by d of phi the set of points x for which phi is finite, which is a convex subset. And again, in our case, the domain of phi will be H12. And for x in the domain of phi, I will define the subdifferential of phi at x, as the collection of slopes. So these are really dual objects. This should be taught really as elements of the dual. But of course, I will identify them with the vectors of H, such that phi of y is greater than phi of x plus xi y minus x for any y. Okay, so it's the set of directions of supporting hyperplanes. So it's the slope of a supporting hyperplane to the graph of phi at the point x. So in our case, we take as a definition of the Laplacian Okay, sorry, I should have added something. This is a convex closed subset. Again, it's easy to check that this is a convex closed subset. So again, I can take the element of minimal norm, which I will denote by nabla phi. This is really a vector of my space. And now, in our case, I define as Laplacian minus the gradient of the Cheeger energy at F. Okay, so let me rewrite now the this definition. So in our language, the Laplacian will be a vector, and the vector with smallest L2 norm, satisfying this property that the Cheeger energy of G, okay, let me write maybe in this way. Minus, because xi is equal to minus h delta f dn for any h in h1. Okay? So for us, the Laplacian will be defined by this formula. Okay? Again, an important warning. Delta, again, this is very misleading notation, is non-linear in general. It's a non-linear operator because in some sense it's the gradient of something which is not quadratic in general. So for instance, by exercise you could compute what is the Laplacian in the L-infinity example. In the L-infinity example you will find a second order non-linear operator. Of course, unless if the Cheeger energy is quadratic, then you get, of course, you get a linear operator. Okay, this is for the definition of the Laplacian, and now what about the definition of the heat flow? Now, I restated the basic theorem. The basic theorem of the maximal monotope operators theory. Theorem. So for any initial condition x naught in the closure of the domain of phi, phi remember was a convex lower semi-continuous functional in my Hilbert space, there is a unique solution xt to the Cauchy problem . Actually, the Cauchy problem can be stated as a differential inclusion. So you're just saying that for almost every time, your velocity should go into opposite, in a direction opposite to some element in the sum differential, with x locally absolutely continuous. X. You see, it's only locally absolutely continuous because I'm considering also initial conditions with infinite energy. So in the case, for instance, of Dirichlet energy, you could start from any function in L2. So you, since you start with infinite energy, you have only local absolute continuity. And the initial condition is that the limit as t goes to zero . So this Cauchy problem has a unique solution, and then there are several regularizing effects, which I can mention here only briefly, but they are part of this classical theory. The regularizing effects, for instance, the main ones for us are, first of all, that for almost every time, this unique solution selects really the gradient. So you start with a differential inclusion, but at the end you get an equation. And the second important fact, which plays sometimes a role, is that the right derivative exists for any time. So you get really a pointwise equation, provided you work with the right derivative. Not only almost everywhere, but for any positive time you get. Okay, and so in our case, we get to, with our notation, we really get the heat flow, right? So coming back to our particular case, for any, since the closure of H12 contains the closure of Lipschitz, which is L2, we can solve our problem for any initial condition.
What is the idea of the uniqueness proof from the theorem?
Well, yeah, it requires some work. Okay, the formal idea is this. Okay, maybe I complete this statement and then I give you the formal idea. I mean, coming back to our particular situation where we were working with the Cheeger energy, the closure of the Sobolev space is L2. And so for any F0 in L2, I can find a unique solution Ft to the heat equation. For instance, our solution becomes a little tautological, right? Because delta was defined precisely in this way. But we will see that this is the right point of view. And the usual warning, this is not a linear equation in general, because the Laplacian is a nonlinear operator. But for this nonlinear PDE, we have existence and uniqueness. Okay, now coming back to your question, the uniqueness comes from this monotonicity problem. In fact, this is where the name also monotone operators comes. So this operator, which is a multivalued operator, because in principle associated to any x, you might have many different slopes, right? So this is a multivalued operator, is monotone. What does it mean? This comes out of convexity. This means that P minus Q, X minus Y, is always non-negative whenever you choose P in the subdifferential of phi at X and Q in the subdifferential of phi at Y. Okay? This is a simple property that you can check just as a consequence of convexity. Okay? Once you have this monotonicity property, take two different solutions and let's try to differentiate their L2 norm. Okay, sketch of uniqueness. So take two different solutions, starting from the same point, so you know that this quantity is zero at the origin. And then you get here x prime 1 of t minus x prime 2 of t. X1 of t minus x2 of t. But remember that this is now opposite to an element in the subdifferential in this point, and this is opposite to an element in the subdifferential at this point. And so you can use this monotonicity property to say that this is negative. So in fact, this is a case where you have not only uniqueness, but really contractivity. So the flow associated to the solutions is contractive. You see, so in particular you have uniqueness. Okay. And so now we have our solution to the heat flow. And what is important also for some applications is that we have an integration by parts formula. This is a bit surprising because a priori the operator is non-linear, but still we have an integration by parts formula, which says that minus the integral of g delta f dm is less than you see this is the inequality you would have in a classical setting, because after integrating by parts here you would get nabla g nabla f, right, with equality. If g is a function of f, is a non-decreasing function of f. Okay, so for today, maybe I will stop. I will just give this proof and then we can stop. Okay, let us fix an epsilon positive, and we consider the Cheeger energy of f plus epsilon g. Okay, by the definition of subdifferential, this is larger than the Cheeger energy of f minus epsilon. Okay, here I just applied the definition of subdifferential, because minus delta F is in the subdifferential of the Cheeger energy, is by definition the element with minimal norm. Actually, this proof would work with any element in the subdifferential. Well, on the other hand, one can easily check that df by convexity, df star plus epsilon dg star is a relaxed slope of f plus epsilon g. Right? Because if you can approximate f, you can approximate g, then combining the two approximations, you get something which is still an upper bound, a relaxed slope for f plus epsilon g. And so you can bound this by the definition of Cheeger energy, because in the Cheeger energy we have put the minimal object, the minimal relaxed slope. And so here, if you expand this square, you get that this is the Cheeger energy plus the integral epsilon times di F star di G star plus a quadratic term. And so if you in this chain of inequalities you simplify and you divide by epsilon, you get okay, just a refinement of this argument, which is based on the fact that in the chain rule formula we know that we have equality when phi is non-decreasing. Just a refinement of this argument tells you that if g is a non-decreasing function of f, then you have equality here. In particular, I say also this and then we stop. In particular, you can take g equal 1. So here we are in a compact case, so I can take g equal 1. And this tells me that g, of course, will be a function of f. And so this tells me that the integral of delta f is equal to 0. But this is also the integral when you study the heat flow. And so this means that is constant along the heat flow. Okay, and I think maybe tomorrow we can restart from here. I need a few more properties of the heat flow, and then we start to discuss the W subspaces.